Something just happens that warms the cockles of my heart. I was about to ask Lee if I should start the panel, and everybody was quiet. That's spontaneous order. This is the 9:30 panel on natural law and natural rights, and the schedule says that Michael Uhlman should be moderating. For you who don't know me, I'm not Michael Uhlman. No, I'm Eric Claeys, and I'm a professor of law at George Mason University, and I was on the organizing committee for this panel. Michael Uhlman had his flight canceled anticipatorily on Thursday, so he couldn't be here today, and he sends his regrets. Michael is affiliated with the Claremont Institute, and I'd like to thank the Claremont Institute for helping to come up with the idea for this panel and to support it, and I'd also like to thank the Federalist Society for supporting it as well. And in my opening remarks, I want to just give a brief background of where this panel came from and what it's trying to do. So legal academia has many different methodologies represented in it, and some are better respected than others, some are more mainline than others. And one useful function that outside groups like the Federalist Society and the Claremont Institute can serve is to try to get a better seat at the table for methodologies that seem heterodox but might deserve better consideration. And we've had a recent in-depth analysis of this process in Stephen Tellis's book, The Rise of the Conservative Legal Movement. And Professor Tellis figures a couple of outside groups outside legal academia, like the Federalist Society, and he studies the way in which these groups made more respectable or maybe notorious some new methodologies like originalism and statutory and constitutional interpretation, or the use of law and economics to study lots of different regulatory fields. And so the basic idea of this panel is, well, if it worked for originalism and it worked for law and economics, why not some other methodologies? And why not natural rights and or natural law? And in some respects, natural rights and natural law would seem to be some prime candidate or candidates for a methodology that deserves a better seat at the table. One can see the common law shot through with natural law reasoning in its normative structure, and the natural law relies a lot on normative concepts one sees in natural law treatises. I write in property law, and Blackstone and Kent's treatments of property go back to a natural right to labor very quickly. And in constitutional law, one only needs to look at the founding to look at the declarations of rights in most state constitutions to see how close the connections were between constitutional rights and background natural rights. Or in the anti-slavery movement, there were lots of abolitionist tracts used in the antebellum period, and those antebellum tracts had a huge influence on the development of anti-slavery ideology and then on the ratification and the language of the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. But natural law and natural rights in some other respects are much more problematic candidates to get a seat back at the table. Originalism is kind of understood in contemporary discourse as having a political valence. Conservative presidential candidates campaign about originalism and strict construction, and left liberal candidates campaign on living constitutionalism. Natural law talk and natural rights talk, it's not nearly so obvious which way the valence cuts. There are social conservatives who like natural law, libertarians who like natural rights, and left liberals who argue from natural law or natural rights as well. And unlike law and economics tends to assume and to work with preferences for social science foundations, natural law and natural rights in a lot of ways precede those foundations and so seem much less familiar and more problematic to contemporary academics who prefer to study social science, to study contemporary phenomena using social science concepts. So we picked some papers that we hope would spark a discussion about what natural law and natural rights are, how they can be used in scholarship, and what the problems might be. And there were many fine papers to pick from when the selection committee picked papers. We tried to pick ones in part on the basis of the merits, but in part on the basis of their ability to spark a conversation about the kinds of themes I just mentioned. So the first paper we have today takes what might be called a top-down approach. And the pre-colon title of this paper is What Rights Are and Why There Are Any. It's by Professor Michael Baur, a professor of philosophy with a cross appointment at the law school of Fordham University. And Professor Baur is a philosopher, and he's studying philosophically the character for natural rights in the course of doing so, he's making responses to philosophical characterizations about rights that resemble in many ways the assumptions that many contemporary law professors bring to how they understand natural rights. If Professor Baur's paper is top-down, the other paper today is more bottom-up. This paper is called, the pre-colon title of it is Self-Defense Under Siege. It's a co-authored paper. The co-author who's here with us today is Lieutenant Colonel Brian Bengs. The paper is about maybe the most urgent and primal natural right, the right of self-defense, but it's a law reform paper. The paper is focusing on the rules of engagement that combatants must follow under international law and military law, and it's appealing to the natural law and natural rights tradition or traditions to argue that these rules ought to be changed. And it's interesting to think about why there is a natural right to self-defense, but it's also interesting to ask about whether principles of natural law and natural rights have enough specificity or traction that somebody can make an argument in a paper proposing to change some very specific cutting-edge doctrinal issue on the basis of those grounds. For our panelists today also include three commentators. We're honored and grateful to have Professor Michael Moreland, an associate dean at Villanova, who'll comment on Professor Baur's paper. We're also honored and grateful to have Professor Jeremy Rabkin, my colleague at George Mason University. He'll comment on Lieutenant Colonel Bengs's paper. And we also are grateful to have Rick Hills, the William Comfort Professor of Law at New York University. He's been invited to be the gracious House skeptic to provide a more skeptical comment on both papers. And we'll have each of the paper presenters have 12 minutes, followed by the commenter who's focusing specifically on his paper, and we'll start with Professor Baur.
Thank you for that introduction, and thank you for being here. Thanks in advance for listening. I have 12 minutes, so I'll move fairly quickly. I won't be able to cover everything, but I'll try and truncate in ways that still make the paper intelligible. It's often thought that natural rights are independent, self-standing, pre-social rights that exist apart from and prior to all human interactions, and thus are absolute in the sense that concern for such rights ought to trump, as Ronald Dworkin says, considerations of social utility. It's easy to conclude from this conception of natural rights, which would include, for example, the natural right to life, that a natural right is violated when anyone is killed as a result of human interactions. It's equally easy to conclude from this conception of natural rights that natural rights are so important and so absolute that their protection requires at times the flouting of merely social or conventional or positive arrangements, in the case of citizen activists, for example, and also requires instances of judicial activism in the case of judges. There's a great deal of natural law literature which suggests, in effect, that the existence of absolute natural rights gives license to judges to engage in judicial activism in several instances. I want to say that this conceptual of natural rights as independent, self-standing, and pre-social rights rests on a mistake. I want to say that natural rights are indeed inviolable. Indeed, all rights are inviolable in the sense that any act of doing an injustice, any act of violating rights, is wrong under any description, even though all rights, including even natural rights, are in their very essence relational. Now, in order to make my case, and I can't make it fully, I'll have to skip over some issues that may be quite relevant, but in order to make the case, I need to say something about the meaning of rights in general, and I'll make my case by drawing on the thought of Aristotle and Aquinas, whose natural law thinking, I believe, has been overlooked, underappreciated, and often misconstrued by contemporary natural law thinkers, even those who consider themselves to be Aristotelians or Thomists. Let me invite you to think a little bit about our ordinary language by means of which we talk about rights. We often distinguish in our ordinary language between misfortunes and injustices. Consider someone who might die because of a lightning strike or die in an earthquake. And if you ask yourself, in one of those two instances, has a misfortune occurred or an injustice occurred that someone should die by being hit by lightning or die in an earthquake? The natural law account that I want to put forward tells us that we have to first ask, it depends. What's the context? If I'm in the middle of an open field and a storm arises, contrary to anyone's expectation, and I'm struck by lightning and killed, it might just be a misfortune. If, however, I happen to be in a municipal park after dark and the warden or caretaker of the park failed to close the fence or failed to put a sign saying that one is not allowed in the park after dark or during a storm, then in fact it may be the case that my dying because of a lightning strike in the park after dark is a matter of injustice. The lesson in these observations is this. The question of whether a particular scenario is properly understood in terms of a misfortune or an injustice, that is, a violation of rights, depends not simply on the nature or character of the harm done to some individual person. It depends rather on whether or not the harm done is properly traceable or attributable to the free and responsible agency of some other individual person. The lesson, in other words, is the question of whether or not an injustice has been done and a right violated depends fundamentally on relations between two or more persons and not merely on relations between a particular person and a particular harm done. It's exceedingly important in this context to observe that the notion of rights, including even the notion of natural rights, can have no defensible meaning apart from the notion of justice. In turn, the notion of justice can have no defensible meaning apart from the notion of a community of two or more members whose acts or works can be regarded as equal or commensurated to one another in some relevant respect. That is, whose acts or works can be regarded as instantiating a kind of equality in some relevant respect. As Aristotle notes, it's generally accepted that injustice involves some sort of inequality and injustice involves some sort of inequality and justice some kind of equality. And Aquinas further observes, a thing is not said to be equal to itself, strictly speaking, it's identical to itself. Strictly speaking, a thing is to be equal, said to be equal only to something other than itself and in some respect. And so on the Aristotelian-Thomistic analysis that I want to offer, the proper object of justice, right, jus, which is a kind of ordering, the proper object of justice is right or jus, which is a kind of ordering or adjustment according to which acts or works of separate individuals are regarded as equal or commensurate in some respect. One immediate implication of this account of right and rights is that rights are inescapably relational. To possess a right on this analysis is not to possess a power or liberty or natural property, such as the property of having kneecaps or earlobes, that one would possess apart from any relation to others. Rather, to possess a right is to occupy a place within an order or an arrangement, or what I want to call a circle of justice. A circle of justice that's embedded within some community or group, such that individuals within the circle of justice can be seen as equals in some relevant respect. To the extent that the proper equality between individuals is observed, then rights, whether natural or positive, are respected. To the extent that the proper equality is not observed, then rights, whether natural or positive, are violated. A quick observation just about terminology. On the analysis I'm putting forward, what is meant by a community, or the very term community, pertains to a set of individuals that are ordered to some common end. Aquinas calls it a common good, and thereby ordered in relation to one another in accordance with some common organizing principle. And a circle of justice pertains to a set of relations that obtains between individual members of a community such that equals can be treated as equals in some relevant respect, that is, such that justice can be done and rights can be respected within that community. While there can be no such thing as a circle of justice that's not embedded within some properly constituted community that's ordered to a common end, there, however, can exist communities that do not automatically entail a corresponding and coexisting, coextensive circle of justice. One can think of family relations where one wouldn't insist on justice relations throughout. Now, according to this account, it's possible for individuals to be related to one another in a wide variety of ways and to be capable of doing justice or injustice to one another in a wide variety of ways, all depending on whether they share membership in one or another kind of community or circle of justice. But the crucial thing to note is that it's only on the basis of some common membership in a community which underwrites a circle of justice that one can talk meaningfully about duties of justice owed and duties of justice violated, and thus about rights possessed and rights violated. For on the account that I'm putting forward, to say that an individual has a duty of justice is to say that the individual ought to treat some other individual on terms that are equal in some relevant respect to the terms under which other individuals within that circle of justice are treated. To say that an individual has a right is to say that the individual ought to be treated on terms that are equal in some relevant respect. Note that the existence of duties and rights within a particular circle of justice does not require equal treatment in every respect, but only equal treatment in some respect that's relevant to the way that members relate to one another and relate to the community as a whole, precisely as members of that community or circle of justice. So, for example, equal treatment of employees within a particular manufacturing firm may require the payment of equal wages for equal work done, where such equal treatment may indeed incorporate a policy giving differential benefits available, of course, to all employees, but differential benefits based on the employee's level of education or productivity and so forth. But equal treatment within this manufacturing firm would not require equal treatment in some respect that's irrelevant to the aim of the firm and the tasks of the individual employees within it. So equal treatment here would not require payment of equal wages to employees who are equally tall or equally good looking. Here, equal treatment always means equal treatment in some relevant respect, given the proper nature and goals or the common end of the community that underwrites the circle of justice. It's possible, of course, to think of different individuals as being related to each other in a wide variety of ways and within the context of a wide variety of communities and circles of justice that give those individuals a wide variety of rights and duties with respect to one another. So, for example, an individual may have rights and duties with respect to others by virtue of his or her membership in a particular family or labor union or social club. Within the traditional family, the rights and duties of justice between spouses would pertain to matters such as marital fidelity and access to the family's assets. Within the labor union or social club, the rights and duties of justice might pertain to matters such as the payment of dues or attendance at meetings. Now, two different communities, such as a labor union and a social club, may happen to have some members in common, in which case there's an overlapping membership. Or they may have no members in common, in which case there is no overlapping membership. Where there's overlapping membership, those individuals who happen to share membership in two or more different circles of justice will have more than one set of rights and duties with respect to one another. So, for example, such individuals may owe it to each other as members of the labor union to attend the union's regular meetings. They may owe it to each other as members of the social club to take turns organizing monthly social events. When any individual members fail to render what's owed to the others within the context of the particular community or circle of justice, there's said to be an injustice and thus a violation of right. Let me skip over because I'm running out of time. So the idea is the rights that individuals have depend upon the roles that they play within a community and circle of justice, and that those roles are determined by the end or goal of that community or circle of justice. Now, just like a social club or labor union, a political community has its own unity and goals and principles that organize it. And it also institutes a set of rules which carve out roles for individuals so that they can act in ways that, of course, satisfy their own desires, but at the same time contribute in some way to the common good. And thus, there's the famous argument that Aristotle and Thomas make for privacy and private property. Importantly, it's a common good argument for the existence of privacy and private property. They say something like this: if everything's held in common, if there's too much unity within the political community, then that very unity will be destroyed. Why? Because people will not care about things. They'll allow things to fall into disrepair. They'll become confused about who gets to use what and when. They'll bicker with each other. They'll be discontented when their expectations about using things are frustrated. After all, they expect that everybody owns everything together. So the argument for privacy and private property, which Aristotle famously makes against Plato and Aquinas adopts, depends upon a view to the common good. The idea is you want an efficient political community where there's no bickering and no confusion. You give people their own stuff in order to make that happen. One can make a similar argument for natural rights, where the natural community, the species of human beings, is what constitutes the goal, the common natural class within which people belong and belong to as equals in that respect. But since my time's up, I'll conclude there, and of course I'm open to further questions. The idea, though, is rights are relational, which still is open to the possibility of saying that they're inviolable, because it's always wrong to treat equals unequally or unequals equally. Thank you.
Professor Michael Moreland. you, Eric, for and to Michael Ullman for organizing this panel, and to Michael Baur for this interesting and splendid paper. I'm, of course, deeply sympathetic to much of what Professor Baur has said about the relevance of Aristotle and Aquinas to some of the issues that law professors deal with, but let me talk a little bit about what some of those issues are. I also think it's especially appropriate that we have a panel like this at the Federalist Society, because one of the great things that the Federalist Society has been well recognized for is its ability to bring together a diversity of perspectives on law, particularly those of libertarians and traditional conservatives, who, as Eric mentioned at the outset, I think have been informed by different accounts of what different accounts of justice, basically different political theories and economic analysis of law and social contract, kind of Nozickian natural rights theories in the libertarian vein, and then for traditional conservatives, often accounts of natural law. Now, of course, there's been a dominance of the former, that is, the more libertarian views, I think, in most legal thought, and so this paper and this panel, I think, are an important contribution to the salience of the latter traditional conservative natural law view. So let me make 2 points applying Professor Baur's paper and insights to American law and legal scholarship. The first is in the area of torts, which is one of my own areas of teaching and scholarship, which I think has been dominated for several decades now by a kind of a public law view overcoming the private law character of torts. That, as I put it once, that there's a tendency to hit every legal nail with a public law hammer. And so the law of torts has been, I think, overcome for several decades now by kind of public law considerations. And this is something that Ernest Weinreb, a Canadian legal scholar who's a Kantian natural lawyer of a kind, I suppose, calls these functionalist accounts of private law that are concerned, as he says, quote, with whether the results of cases promote the postulated goals. But there's been a recent and I think important, I think natural lawyers especially can contribute to this recovery, a recent underscoring, though, of the integral kind of private law orientation of torts as a private law of wrongs, private law of remedies. I think this is most probably familiar to those who work in the torts field and the private law field, in the United States at least, in the work of John Goldberg and Ben Zapersky, a colleague of Michael's at Fordham, in their so-called civil recourse theory. But the civil recourse theory, which is oriented around torts as, again, a theory of rights and remedies, of responsibilities and redress, has, by Zapersky and Goldberg's admission, been offered as a merely descriptive, or as they put it, conceptual account of what the law of torts is trying to achieve. And I think natural lawyers can contribute to this debate by giving a normative or moral account of what the law of torts is trying to achieve in various ways. And so, and that I think something like Professor Baur's account here of natural rights can contribute to some of that thinking. As John Finnis, probably the leading living legal legal philosophical proponent of natural law, put it in an essay once, on the whole, the developed common law of tort, like the developed civil law of delect, embodies a true understanding of persons, of their worth, of their efficacious freedom to choose well or badly. The classic name for that true practical understanding of principles is natural law. So that's one area where I think law professors can learn from many of the insights that Professor Baur offers here. Now let me add a slightly skeptical note then in my second comment about how law professors can incorporate much of what he says here. And that's when it comes to natural rights and natural law and decisions involving constitutional and political structure. I probably won't be quite as skeptical as Rick Hills will be about this, but I do think that there's a tendency on the part of proponents of natural law sometimes to insufficiently take seriously the brute fact of moral disagreement and pluralism in the social order. And this is something that philosophers such as Alistair MacIntyre pointed out for a long time, that if you have the natural lawyer's view of practical reason, it very quickly becomes difficult to understand how people come to disagree so sharply and pervasively about what natural law requires, and then correlatively what rights there are to be protected as a matter of natural rights. I mean, are there natural rights to, I mean, we could multiply, obviously, many such examples, but abortion, same-sex marriage, assisted suicide, recreational drug use, religious exemptions from generally applicable laws, and so forth. And so what are we to make of this brute fact of moral disagreement in our decisions regarding constitutional and political structure. And I think this point is especially pertinent to what Professor Baur said briefly in his summary of his paper here about the relation between lower order communities and higher order communities such as the state, and the way in which pluralism in the civil order develops, and the challenges posed by such pluralism and the pervasive moral disagreement we encounter. And I think we've come up over the last several decades with different strategies to address this. John Rawls's view on the theory of justice, right on the first page, in fact, of A Theory of Justice, is to say, well, justice is only about major social institutions, right? It's not a personal virtue. It's not a pervasive social virtue. It's only governing the major institutions of the social order, and then that later comes in Rawls's view to be complemented by an overlapping consensus that helps us overcome such divisiveness and pluralism in society. But I think it's the skepticism born of this kind of moral disagreement that fuels skepticism about natural rights claims, at least as articulated in the natural law tradition more generally. And I think this difficulty is on especially prominent display when it comes to ask how to operationalize something like a natural law view of natural law, natural law view of what natural rights are constituted by in judicial decision-making about constitutional structure and about what rights there are that should be protected in our constitutional order. And just by way of example and by conclusion, I think you see this on display in at least a couple cases in interesting and very different ways. In one, Heller versus District of Columbia, there's actually a very brief passage in the majority opinion that suggests that this natural right of self-defense, about which we'll hear much more soon, informs in turn what rights of Englishmen were meant to be protected in the English Bill of Rights and then in our own Second Amendment. And so this helps us understand then, in the view of the court in Heller, what the rights protected by the Second Amendment might be. So that might be one way to kind of operationalize this. But another way, and very different, I think, much more born of skepticism, would be something like the decision in Glucksberg versus Washington involving whether there's a right to assisted suicide protected by the substantive due process provisions of the 14th Amendment, where I think the Chief Justice Rehnquist's view there is that his sort of Oakeshottian skepticism about our moral disagreements and our ability to resolve them results in a view that federalism is the best way to resolve these, right? That you leave it up to the states and local orders to figure out whether these rights should be protected as a matter of positive law or not. But I think this points up, as I said, I think some of the difficulties of this theory, but all in all, I'm a sympathetic listener to what Professor Baur said. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Moreland. Now, Lieutenant Colonel Bengs.
Okay, unlike the others, I have to begin with a disclaimer. I am an Air Force officer, and as such, I'm accordingly an employee of the United States government. What I'm going to tell you is not the position of the United States Air Force or the United States government, which for reasons will become obvious very soon. They are my position and my opinions only on this topic, so bear that in mind. Now, when I teach, I normally ask questions to try to get audience interaction, so I'll just talk out a little bit of questions here. If you're walking around New York City tonight and someone points a weapon at you, says that you are not welcome in his turf and your mistake will cost you your life, can you lawfully kill the assailant to protect yourself? And the answer, obviously, everybody's going, of course I can. Why would anybody deny me that right? But who decides when you should use deadly force? When is that decision made? Where is that decision made? These are things that are very important, and obviously you would want to make that decision for yourself. So what is the risk of killing your assailant? In the United States, as a civilian, in any city, in any state, the risk is solely, well, maybe if I got it wrong. Maybe I didn't meet the criteria that the state says this is what you need to assert self-defense. Then I could be in trouble for a potential homicide. But if I meet the criteria, no, I'm fine. I walk away. Now imagine that you are a junior U.S. military member deployed to Afghanistan to support ISAF efforts fighting the Taliban. You're 19, 20 years old. You're walking around an Afghan village on patrol with others from your unit when someone points an automatic weapon at you and opens fire. Can you lawfully kill the assailant to protect your own life? That is what we are talking about here. Can you do that? And as a civilian, you would say, they're shooting at me. Yes, of course, I have a weapon. I'm going to shoot back. But the answer is not that easy in reality. In 2005, a change to the U.S. Standing Rules of Engagement makes the answer to these easy questions about who decides, when they decide, where they decide, quite different than they are for everyone here in New York at the time. The Standard Rules of Engagement from 2000 defines individual self-defense as, quote, the inherent right to use all necessary means available and to take all appropriate actions to defend oneself and U.S. forces in one's vicinity from a hostile act or demonstrated hostile intent, unquote. In contrast, the Standing Rules of Engagement from 2005 defines self-defense quite differently. Quote, unit commanders always retain the inherent right and obligation to exercise unit self-defense in response to a hostile act or demonstrated hostile intent. Unless otherwise directed by a unit commander, military members may exercise individual self-defense in response to a hostile act or demonstrated hostile intent. When individuals are assigned and acting as part of a unit, individual self-defense should be considered as a subset of unit self-defense. As such, unit commanders may limit individual self-defense by members of their unit, unquote. So who makes the decision? When do they make the decision? Where are they when they make that decision? It's not your decision, unless you are the unit commander. Notably, both definitions refer to self-defense as an inherent right, language strongly indicative of the concept's natural law origins. The big difference, of course, is that prior to 2005, an individual military member had this inherent right themselves to determine when the use of force and self-defense was warranted. But since 2005, the inherent right of self-defense has belonged to the military unit, and discretion to use force and individual self-defense belongs to the unit commander who may or may or not authorize its use. This fundamental paradigm shift was driven by the nature of counterinsurgency warfare in Iraq and Afghanistan, where unit commanders aspired to win hearts and minds by closely controlling the tactical operations of their troops, thereby minimizing any possibility of alienating the local civilian population. Counterinsurgency doctrine concisely summarizes this concept in the statement, sometimes doing nothing is the best reaction. That essentially summarizes the problem. While the 2005 change makes complete sense from a strategic perspective, for U.S. military personnel under fire at the tactical level, the practical implications have a very real, very deadly consequence that can require them to choose between using force to defend themselves and their friends or breaking the law, and thereby facing a criminal prosecution for not following orders. This is best demonstrated in a situation that has been in the news a fair amount in the last couple of years. On the 8th of September 2009, in the Ganjgal Valley in Afghanistan, a battle raged when a joint U.S.-Afghan force sent to meet village leaders was ambushed by a larger Taliban force firing rocket-propelled grenades, mortars, and machine guns down on them from fortified positions on the slopes above. Positioned a short distance away, Marine Corporal Dakota Meyer and Staff Sergeant Rodriguez Chavez watched as the valley erupted in fire. A radio request to headquarters by the individuals under fire seeking artillery support or air support was denied. So individuals were taking fire. Thanks, but no thanks. Take care of it yourself. With no other help on the way, Corporal Meyer radioed headquarters for permission to join the engagement in defense of his colleagues. Natural reaction. Any of us here would probably do the same. Headquarters denied his request, and the second, and the third, and the fourth. So four times he asked, can I go in and help them out? Four times he was denied by headquarters. Recall that prior to 2005, Corporal Meyer would have not had to ask. He would have had the inherent right to take all appropriate actions to defend himself and the U.S. forces in the vicinity. But he did not have the discretion to make that decision in September of 2008. But that authority was vested in the unit leadership at headquarters. So somebody else, not on the scene, miles away. Deciding that they could not just stand by and watch their colleagues die, the two jumped into a Humvee where Corporal Meyer manned the turret gun. Rushing into the kill zone, Corporal Meyer picked up fallen Afghan soldiers to place them into the Humvee and drive them back to safety. Then the pair turned around and went in for a second, third, fourth trip, by which time Corporal Meyer was wounded in the arm by shrapnel. When the duo made the final fifth trip, in violation of orders each time, approximately 8 to 9 hours after the battle began, they found the lifeless bodies of four Americans lying together. These were the individuals who had requested support. Still under fire, they retrieved the bodies. Ultimately, the pair was credited with saving the lives of approximately 36 personnel. For their actions that day, Corporal Meyer was awarded the Medal of Honor, and Staff Sergeant Rodriguez Chavez received the Navy Cross, while an official investigation into headquarters' refusal to support the requested artillery or air support concluded that three officers in battalion leadership had exhibited, quote, negligent leadership, unquote, which contributed to the loss of life. Two of the three were administratively disciplined, so they had bad marks on their record. Besides being an interesting story, implicit within this tale of that battle is an important issue of natural law. Individual self-defense is firmly rooted within natural law as opposed to positive law, which is based upon a revocable grant from a sovereign. Accordingly, a sovereign simply cannot unilaterally revoke or limit an individual military member's exercise of or claim to what was previously recognized by that same sovereign as an inherent right, as the U.S. did in the 2005 Standing Rules of Engagement. As we all learned in law school, law emanates from a sovereign, positive law. In contrast, natural law is fundamentally sovereignless law. It stems from logic and moral reasoning rather than the political decisions of a government. It is premised upon the idea that certain natural inclinations are so basic to humanity that they are and must be recognized as law. The concept of natural law has a long history. Aristotle described natural law as enacted because just. Cicero described it as not written, but born with us, sucked in and imbibed from nature itself. With these words, Cicero was specifically referring to the right of self-defense. In the Middle Ages, Thomas Aquinas reasoned that all law is based upon the principle that good ought to be done and pursued and that evil ought to be avoided. One essential good is self-preservation, which he used to articulate the right of individual self-defense. A recognized right of self-defense has existed since the start of Western civilization. Ancient Athens recognized it, as did the ancient Hebrews, so did the Romans, who honored it as something permissible to repel force by force, which they viewed as conferred by nature. After the 1648 Peace of Westphalia gave birth to the modern system of sovereign states, 17th and 18th century development of the law of nations expanded upon Aquinas' prior work by applying natural law concepts to states. In this regard, none were more notable than the father of international law, Dutchman Hugo Grotius. Regarding self-defense, Grotius recognized the natural law right when he wrote that, quote, nature commits to each his own protection, unquote. He referred to individual self-defense as private war and used his principles to extrapolate principles justifying war between states referred to as public war. More recently, the Supreme Court itself has identified an individual's inherent right of self-defense in the 2008 District of Columbia versus Heller decision as central to the Second Amendment right to possess a weapon. The majority examined natural law sources to conclude that the amendment effectuated what Blackstone referred to as, quote, the right of having and using arms for self-preservation and defense, unquote. Inasmuch as Blackstone relied upon natural law in making that statement, the U.S. Supreme Court also relied upon natural law in articulating its decision. International treaties also contain provisions indicative of a natural law right to self-defense. The European Convention on Human Rights provides that action taken, quote, in defense of any person from unlawful violence, unquote, shall not be regarded as an arbitrary deprivation of the right to life. Similarly, the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court expressly precludes criminal liability for anyone who, quote, acted reasonably to defend himself or herself or another person, unquote. Even sovereign states assert a similar international legal right of self-defense grounded upon the same natural law foundation as an individual's right. Article 51 of the UN Charter, an exemplar of positive treaty law, provides, quote, nothing in the present charter shall impair the inherent right of individual or collective self-defense if an armed attack occurs, unquote. In its 1984 case, Nicaragua versus the United States, the International Court of Justice concluded that Article 51 of the Charter is only meaningful on the basis that there is a natural or inherent right of self-defense. As a positive law source, inclusion of the phrase inherent right in the UN Charter provision would not be necessary at all. Yet there it is, just as it was in the USSROE Standing Rules of Engagement from 2000, describing an individual military member's right to self-defense, which takes us back to the primary point of contention. Is it logical or lawful for a sovereign state to unilaterally revoke or limit an individual military member's exercise of or claim to a previously recognized inherent right? The weight of evidence indicating a historically recognized natural law right of individual self-defense is beyond dispute. As recently as the 1940s, there was no dispute that every individual had an absolute preeminent right to defend themselves with force. Today, every state and essentially every nation in the world recognizes and preserves an individual right to use force in response to a threatened use of force. The U.S. Supreme Court itself determined that every citizen has an inherent right of self-defense. What then do you think is the plain meaning of the phrase inherent right? To me, it sounds like a right belonging to an individual, not as the result of a positive grant by a sovereign, but by virtue of an individual's existence. To borrow the explanation of John Locke, the phrase implies a, quote, pre-political right, unquote, that exists independent of sovereign. In the interest of time, it's tempting to consider the internal inconsistencies regarding interpretation and application of relatively obscure natural law self-defense concepts within the U.S. government as little more than a fun intellectual exercise. For Corporal Meyer on that September day in 2009 and countless other military personnel every day in Afghanistan, the topic has a real and immediate importance, forcing them to choose between possible death or criminal conviction for taking actions in self-defense under a universally recognized legal right honored since the dawn of Western civilization.
Thank you very much, Lieutenant Colonel Bengs, and now from Professor Rabkin.
I want to start by saying the paper is really fun. I mean, it really raises really basic issues, and I think it does, it's a kind of effort that does make you think about natural law, and that's really helpful. I think the specific claim can't be right, or at least I'm very dubious about it, which is that members of the military can appeal to some natural right of self-defense to disobey orders. I'll just give you one example. In Locke's Second Treatise, which you might think of as one of the great classic sources of natural rights, he says in chapter 11, even absolute power sometimes may be necessary, but it's different from arbitrary power. And then he gives this example from the common practice of martial discipline. For the preservation of the army and in it of the whole commonwealth requires an absolute obedience to the command of every superior officer. And it's justly death to disobey or dispute the most dangerous or unreasonable of these orders. We see that neither the sergeant that could command a soldier to march up to the mouth of a cannon or stand in a breach where he's almost certain to perish can command that soldier to give him one penny of his money, nor the general that can condemn him to death for deserting his post or for not obeying the most desperate orders can yet, with all his absolute power of life and death, dispose of one farthing of that soldier's estate. So Locke says in the military you can't touch the soldier's personal resources, but of course you can give them orders which are devastating to them, which are likely to result in their loss of life. Grotius says, the father of international law, as you said, says, well, the enemy is entitled to kill you, and since they could kill you after they defeat you, it's natural justice that they can spare your life on the condition that you serve as a slave. And once you agree to that deal, you are bound by it, and you don't have the right to run away, even to save yourself when you think your captor may change his mind. So the military is a very special situation. Still, I think the example that the paper starts with and the presentation here started and ended with, Dakota Meyer, is a very, very good example because it reminds you there are some extreme circumstances where soldiers, the man at the tip of the spear, has to decide, really, did they really mean these orders? Would they have meant these orders if they were here, if they actually understood this? So it seems to me what Sergeant Meyer, or I guess he's now Sergeant, what he did was exercise something like Locke's prerogative. You disobey the law in the interest of public safety. Right? You do what you think is the right thing, but you're taking the risk that you will be afterwards disapproved and get in trouble. And instead, he got the Congressional Medal of Honor. But as you mentioned in the paper, he said, I knew I would be either a hero or a zero. So he understood this was a risk. The main point which I would like to draw out of this paper for this audience is Colonel Bengs and his associate have looked at what we used to do in the United States about self-defense in the military, about what the law is in military law is in Canada, in Australia, NATO, various other settings. And I think that's a really worthwhile thing to do, and it's a worthwhile way of formulating this. If you say the question is, what's the law of the United States, period? Of course, as soon as you say period today, people are on their guard because they know that the president is about to just pull a fast one on you. But put that aside. If you just look at this as what is the law of the United States, you're missing a big dimension of this, which is what really was the United States thinking? How should we understand this in an ambiguous case? How should we apply it in an extreme case? And in that context, where you like a little unsure, what are we really saying, it's very helpful to see what have other countries done. And it's very helpful to know the history of this. And it can be helpful even to know what was thought to be the logic of this by writers who thought it through and gave a kind of more philosophic account. I think particularly international law is very helpful. This is very helpful to international law because there's so few cases. And the cases, it's very disputed what the authority of the cases is. The statute establishing the International Court of Justice stipulates, and the court will decide on the basis of this, 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 and one of the obvious things that's left out is precedent. And that wasn't, ooh, they didn't think of it, is most of the countries agreeing to set up this court didn't want it to be establishing a body of binding law and precedent. So in international law, where it's much more, there's much more uncertainty, it's much more helpful to think about what's the background, what's the reasoning of the background, what's generally accepted by other countries. It maybe is not exactly natural law, but it's something that's sort of in the range of it, which is why we used to have this expression, and it's frequently invoked in Thomas Aquinas, jus gentium, meaning it's the sort of general law of nations, the generally accepted standards of nations. Maybe that's not simply reason, but it's something that helps you to have perspective on the positive law of your place. Still, I think we should remind ourselves, this is a much more compelling kind of argument when you're dealing with international disputes than it is with domestic law, where there are courts, where there's a lot of case law, where you can get in a much more detailed and compelling way what really is our law. At the international level, you can't do that as well, so of course it's more helpful to fall back on reason, logic, practice, consensus of nations. Before I sit down, I just want to say I think this is related to a point of natural law, which is suggested by that passage from Locke, which is the claims of self-defense of nations are inherently stronger than the claims of self-defense of individuals, because nations include a lot of people. And therefore, historically, it's been thought that nations are entitled to do more questionable things to defend themselves than individuals. Let me just give you one example, because it's telling on this point of what does this expression inherent right of self-defense mean that you find in the UN Charter. I think the locus classicus of that is a debate about the Kellogg-Briand Pact in the late 1920s, which is supposed to renounce resort to force as an instrument of diplomacy. And Secretary of State Kellogg said, oh, by the way, this does not mean that you can't use force in self-defense. He sent around a letter to all the people who's trying, all the countries who's trying to get to sign it. And he said, of course the right of self-defense is inherent. We're not giving that up. And we just don't want to define what it is, because we can't really define what it is, because it could be anything. And when the Kellogg-Briand Pact went to the Senate said, yes, great, we're for it, it's okay. We just want to stipulate. One of the things that we regard as part of our inherent right of self-defense is any violation of the Monroe Doctrine. So if anyone anywhere in our hemisphere is attacked, we are ready to go, because we need to have that. Right? I think no one would claim that as an individual right of self-defense. But on Locke's ground, and I think many other natural law, call them teachers, it makes sense that nations claim more for themselves than individuals could claim, because national governments have a kind of inherent dignity because they're defending a whole lot of people. And I think it helps you to understand an important continuum between pre-modern and modern natural law, which is the right of self-defense is in a very fundamental way connected to the obligation to establish and maintain just political communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Rabkin. Last, Professor Hills.
I'll just sit here, because I was wondering why the Federalist Society would call an old positivist consequentialist out on a cold Saturday morning all the way from Brooklyn to go north of 14th Street to comment on natural law papers. What do I know about natural law? And I assume that my role is to provide ornery and skeptical remarks, so I'll do so very quickly. The way I want to proceed very quickly is to first talk about how a consequentialist like myself would think about such rights. And I want to use Colonel Bengs' very good example of self-defense. And then I want to talk about how natural lawyers think about natural rights. And my conclusion will be, I don't have the slightest idea. How does a consequentialist think about rights? Well, I'd ask whether humans would be left better off as a result of a proposed rule. I take every right to be a rule. So would we be better off with a robust theory of soldier self-defense? And I think about that by asking, what would minimize the sum of civilian casualties and loss of limb, soldier casualties and loss of limb, and erosion of a mission that'll presumably do stuff like stop terrorism and promote democracy? I'd add those things up and I'd say, okay, what's the best rule? By the way, I have no idea what the best rule is. I gather that a lot of junior officers' discretion about deploying self-defense could make sense in some circumstances, but not in others. If Colonel Myers was manning an artillery short-range mortar, say, and he got a radio call from embattled soldiers in a densely populated town asking for artillery support, I wouldn't want him to go blasting away in the town if it would cost 100 civilian lives and save four soldiers. First of all, it could lead to a mass lynching of the U.S. military. Second of all, kill 100 civilians. So I really don't know how much discretion Corporal Myers should have, but I do know how I would approach the problem. How do I minimize the sum of costs to everybody concerned? And the costs here seem pretty uncontroversial, loss of life and limb. Now, how do natural lawyers think about this problem? And I really can't tell. Now, part of the problem is when we talk about natural rights, we're talking about two completely, indeed, antithetical bodies of theory. Catholic medieval Thomist theory is deeply at war with early modern 17th century contractarian theory, yet they often go by the same moniker, natural rights. What did the early modern people like Grotius think? Well, the number one thing they thought is they thought Thomas Aquinas was silly, and they rejected scholasticism. They largely believed that rights were derived from a contract reached in an imaginary state of nature. In a state of nature, we enjoy rights to equal freedom. That especially concerns the rights of self-preservation. So if somebody injures you, you on your own initiative can launch what Grotius called in chapter 3 of De Jure Belli, private war. But the idea is that we set up civil government to trade in our rights of equal freedom for the security of, well, government. So we can no longer engage in such self-help. And Grotius was quite clear about this. You do not enjoy an absolute right of self-defense when you feel threatened in a state of civil society. Instead, you go to a judge or a sheriff. And those rights are mitigated or translated by legislative enactments, which might strongly modify your rights of self-defense. Now, the relationship between your natural rights of equal freedom as a savage in the state of nature and your rights as a citizen in civil government is very, very loose in this early modern 17th century theory. Philip Hamburger would say it doesn't exist at all. That basically, you basically traded in all those rights to engage in self-help once you entered into a state of society. What are your rights? They are defined by a legislature, and they are defined by courts. Somebody like Randy Barnett would say, no, there's some much more robust relationship. But whatever the relationship is, it's not going to resolve the kinds of disputes that Colonel Bengs is discussing. Because we'd have to ask whether this right of robust self-defense was alienated when Corporal Myers signed up to join the army. And I just don't know. And neither does Grotius, and neither does Locke, and neither does Pufendorf, or any of the other great early modern theorists of natural rights. So my guess is you probably alienated most of your rights of self-defense when you signed the articles and got your, you know, either commission if you're an officer, or you got your orders when you're a non-com. But like I say, I have no idea. And I don't think that anything in contractarian theory can shed any light on that question. Now let's go to the Thomist theory. The last time I endured Thomist theory is when I tried to get through John Finnis's book describing seven basic goods. There's a lot of basic human goods out there. And Professor Baur says, you know, they're defined by different kinds of communities we live in. We live in overlapping communities. I'm a father, I'm a law professor, I'm a citizen of New York City, I'm a citizen of the United States. Presumably, each of these communities are defined by a different good. Well, Corporal Meyer lived in the U.S. Army. So the U.S. Army, I guess, was defined by some basic good. And I guess we'd look to the goods that that community was trying to promote to figure out what circle of justice defines his right of self-defense. But again, nothing in these generalities will help me figure out in the slightest degree exactly what good the Army is trying to promote that would define any specific kind of right of self-defense. So I gather the Army is trying to promote successful missions. They're trying to minimize the loss of soldier lives. They're also trying to accomplish the mission at a cost of soldier life. How am I supposed to figure out from the notion of a circle of justice defining this community whether that means that Corporal Meyer can blast away to save his comrades, whether he has to hold his fire to spare civilian life? Under the specific facts given by Colonel Bengs, I have no doubt what the right answer is, because there was no risk to civilian life, and he was saving a lot of soldiers' lives. It just sounded like somebody screwed up at Central Command. So I can agree with the bottom line, but if you ask me, does either Grotius or St. Thomas help me figure out the right answer, I have to say I'm completely blanking. If you ask me whether consequentialism helps me figure out the right answer, and in particular a kind of welfarist consequentialist, I tend towards welfarism myself, I'd say, yeah, it gives me a lot of starting points. Don't kill civilians needlessly. Don't sacrifice soldiers' lives needlessly. Try to preserve the mission with both of these ideas in mind. And that's why in the U.S. Army we don't have suicide missions. It is not good for recruiting people. It's demoralizing to the soldiers. It's ineffective in an armed force with high levels of technology. And it's too costly in a non-existential war, a war of choice. See, that's the way I think about this problem. And once you think about that problem this way, the answer becomes simple. The superior screwed up. Colonel Bengs was both Colonel Bengs and Corporal Meyer were right. And there should be, in that circumstance, as a matter of positive law, a right of self-defense. And guess what? There was. He got the Medal of Honor. Now, I know that they changed the standing rules of engagement in 2005, but as every good lawyer knows, positive law that's written is heavily glossed by conventional unwritten law. And there is a conventional unwritten law that when you do something heroic against the orders of a stupid supervisor, you will be rewarded and not punished.
Sometimes.
Yes, sometimes.
Therefore, it's not actually a law.
If you ask me, as a positivist, whether I think there should be a super, super gloss on top of all of this that says, define convention, define written law, define unwritten law, which is also part of positive law. Common law, after all, is positive law. We should have some kind of right of conscientious objection, which judges through their right of conscience, or soldiers through individual judgment, can rely on. I'm inclined to be skeptical. As a positivist, I tend to want to look towards firmer foundations for our rules. And it seems like Colonel Bengs does too, because although he talks a good game about natural law, when it comes right down to it, what he's really trying to do is look at, and I'm going to quote him, previously recognized, historically recognized rules drawn from a lot of common law countries like Australia, the United States, the law of nations, etc. That sounds like positivism to me. Sounds like exactly what a good positivist would do. They'd say, what is the law in fact? As Oliver Wendell Holmes, the arch positivist, said, let's make a prediction about what judges will do in fact. That's what positive law is. Colonel Bengs is making such a prediction, drawing from a wide array of mostly written sources. Corporal Meyer was making such a prediction, drawing from common sense. And I say, that's the best source for good consequentialist law. And we know it's a good source because we look at the consequences of not relying on absolute rights of conscience. We do a lot better in the final result. Look at that.
Thank you very much, Professor Hill. I'd like to offer Professor Baur and Colonel Bengs opportunities for brief responses.
Okay. I'll try and be brief. I have a few comments I want to make. Not only is it the case that, modern philosophers regarded Aquinas as nonsense, his own bishop did. His propositions were condemned in 1277 by the Bishop of Paris. What my own view is that one of the worst things that happened to the thought of Thomas Aquinas, it was canonized by the Catholic Church, because it ended up becoming incorporated in a larger scale agenda-driven operation that often caused the misunderstanding and the misapplication of his thought. The argument about self-defense in battle space, from Aquinas' point of view, would be based on a strictly Platonic, asocial, unhistorical account of rights, which Aquinas and Aristotle directly reject. There is in Aquinas a very serious consideration for instituted arrangements on the basis of which people make judgments. Aquinas doesn't say that we have a right to self-preservation in any unqualified sense. On my own view, if there were that kind of right to self-preservation that was absolute and totally not contingent on any other circumstances, then there would be a right to self-preservation in battle space, regardless of any kind of arrangements, including the military commander's command, in which case there would be a natural right to desert, if in fact that's the only way that I can preserve my own life. Aquinas has a very, very strong sense of the common good. He argues so much so in favor of the priority of the common good to individual goods. He argues that individuals are often put at risk for the sake of the common good. He asks, for example, whether a judge in a capital case who knows privately and personally that the defendant is innocent, whether the judge must acquit or carry through the sentence. And Aquinas says the judge needs to do everything that the judge can do to bring that privately held knowledge to bear within the public forum. But if the judge cannot recuse himself and cannot bring that privately held knowledge to bear in a public forum, the judge must carry out the sentence. Why? It would be more harmful to the common good if judges started thinking for themselves based on private knowledge. Imagine how many families would start baking cakes and things for the defendant, for the judge, society and the reliability of norms would be undermined. So it's a common good natural law argument for the necessity in some cases for individuals to lose their lives by accident or by the necessity of risk in battle space. Another quick observation. The worry about pluralism. I agree that worry absolutely is alive for the natural law thinking of John Finnis, for whom there are these self-evident basic goods. The idea of self-evident basic goods just does not exist in Aristotle and Aquinas. Natural law thinking means you act reasonably and you try and understand the ordering and an arrangement, whether it's a posited or a not posited ordering and arrangement, which is in place for the sake of inducing people to act for the common good. So on the question of pluralism, Finnis and Robert George, for example, argue on the basis of self-evident basic goods that certain things should be prohibited by law. Aquinas says, when he's confronted with the question of whether prostitution should be prohibited by law, he says, no. Not because it's indifferent morally, or not because he's a skeptic, but rather he says, if we were to make certain things prohibited by law, we would be causing more harm to the common good than the evils caused. So certain private evils are allowed, not because we're morally indifferent, not because we can't agree, but because there would be more invasions, more harms to the common good if you tried to regulate. Now Aquinas' argument is based on the idea that people would find other channels for satisfying their wanton lusts, and so you need prostitutes around just a little bit. But the idea is counterintuitive, that even a saint of the Catholic Church argues that you shouldn't prohibit prostitution by law, again, because of the common good and how it would be harmed by certain kinds of regulations.
Colonel Bengs. Okay, just as a little bit of background here, this issue of who decides if I can use force? Because when we send soldiers out into the field, we give them things to use. You have a firearm, you have grenades, you have a radio, you call, hey, can I have an aircraft? I need help. So they have the availability of things to defend themselves. Now, what we've done is interject this possibility of you don't get to decide. You're the one who's right there, but you don't get to decide. So this issue is of supreme importance to individuals. This came to my attention because a few years ago, I was working as an advisor at the Air Operations Center, and I was getting calls from one individual in the field who was the liaison with an aircraft to say, hey, I'm not Army. I'm with the Army, but I'm not Army. I've got I'm a pilot. I can call up the guy in the sky and say, hey, I need a bomb to help us out because the Army commander is not giving the unit the permission to use self-defense. They're just told to hunker down, don't get shot. But he said, can I do this? Can I not do this? So as a matter of practicality, the answer had to be, you can't do that. So from the standpoint of, what's the best result of this? Realistically, you are not going to have anybody in the military if you say, you lose your right to freedom of speech, which we do. No question about that. So nobody has a problem with that.
you lose the right to potentially defend yourself because it's better for you to die than for anybody else to get hurt. The better way to do this, rather than saying you don't get to decide, is saying you still get to decide, but here's the parameters you have to work within. And that's kind of de facto, some of the stuff that I do in the NATO community shows that the U.S., just as a practical matter, doesn't quite have a full grasp on how it wants to do things yet. It says, here's the rules. And then we have a general in Afghanistan, U.S. general, in charge of International Security Assistance Force, saying, he refers to the inherent right of self-defense. Every individual. These orders do not limit this inherent right of self-defense, despite the fact that every individual under the U.S. isn't going to have the inherent right of self-defense unless the unit commander gives them to them. So as a practical matter, from the military operational perspective, from doctrinal perspective, we can't have a, well, you know, maybe, or, you know, you decide for yourself, you know, maybe we'll prosecute you, maybe we won't, maybe we'll give you a medal. It shouldn't be that way. For military personnel, we're trained to, okay, what do you want me to do? You want me to go there? I might die. All right. But I at least want a fighting chance. So if need be, I want the ability to decide to shoot back. And that, I think, is what the core of the problem is that it's injected uncertainty into the system. Who decides? Well, if you decide, maybe you'll give you a medal. If you let the commander decide, maybe you'll be dead. Now, everybody obviously has a vested interest in self-preservation, so the default is probably going to be, at some point, I'm just going to go ahead and risk prosecution, and I'm just going to shoot. You know, everybody's trained on the parameters of you don't want to hurt civilians and everything. As I said, from the strategic perspective, got it. Makes sense. Don't hurt civilians. That creates more problems for us in the future. Perfect sense from the I'm not on the battlefield perspective. I'm just planning this out. When you're on the battlefield being shot at, your perspective is different. And the risk is a problem there. So I don't know that I'm entirely, you know, it's good points regarding Locke and everything, that you give up a lot of rights for military purposes. True. But I don't know that this is the step we want to go, to say you don't decide for yourself what is self-defense.
Thank you very much. And the panelists all kept themselves remarkably and admirably confined to the time constraints. I want to thank them for that. But that leaves us with half an hour or so for questions from the audience and panel discussion. Ilya.
So this is a question. Oh, stop with the mic. Okay. So this is a question for Colonel Bengs, in that you analogize the right of self-defense in the military to what we normally have the right of self-defense in civilian life. But even in civilian life, the law and also moral tradition limits the extent of action you can take in self-defense, the amount of force you can use and the like, and you know, particularly when innocent third parties might be endangered. And it seems to me that this has application in the military sphere as well, in that the weapons available to the military are much more extensive often. The civilian generally can't call in airstrikes to aid them in their self-defense. So, and also, even when civilians do have firearms, personal firearms are often not as you know, powerful and the like as those in the military. And in addition, there's also these extended consequences of, you know, especially in counterinsurgency warfare, maybe more civilians and more members of the military will be killed down the line if you take certain actions in your immediate self-defense. So why can't we say, yes, at some level, there is an inherent right of self-defense in the military, just as in the civilians, but in both cases, it's limited by these potential for third-party effects. And while the general principle is the same, that may translate to more restrictive, specific rules in the military context, where you have A, more powerful weapons, B, a higher probability of negative consequences down the line where third parties might be harmed. And so while the fundamental natural law principle, if you like, is the same, the application is going to be different based on different practical situations, nature of the weapons, and so forth. And that may mean in practice that in some instances, members of the military will not actually be able to effectively defend themselves in a situation where we would allow a civilian to do so if you were in that exact situation of, you know, somebody firing at them from a from ambush or whatnot.
And that's a valid point. And just to be clear, the rules regarding, hey, you can't use artillery or you can't drop a bomb are already in place. in certain parameters of, hey, what's the risk assessment, the collateral damage assessment for if I use a weapon in a town versus it's in the middle of a mountain somewhere. So those places are already there. I think we're confusing a little bit the scope of the ability to defend yourself with the ability to defend yourself. The who decides? Do I get to decide I have an automatic weapon myself? Sure, maybe I can't call in artillery, maybe I can't call in an airstrike because the scope of what they would do is far beyond what I should be able to do and the risk posed, but why can't I use an automatic weapon if I'm being shot at with an automatic weapon? And this is, from the, I tried to stay away from it. The paper approaches this from a comparative law standpoint, as was mentioned, regarding different nations and international organizations, the operational doctrinal standpoint. So there's a lot of things at play here, but I would note that as a military member, I am subject to the Uniform Code of Military Justice. So right now, as an active duty member here, I'm subject to the New York State rules regarding self-defense, and I'm subject to the Uniform Code of Military Justice regarding self-defense. So if I'm walking downtown in New York City, I have the inherent right of self-defense, pursuant to the military's grant of that, which is a special defense under Rule of Court-Martial 916, I believe, that if any evidence comes, I don't even have to assert it. If evidence comes up at a criminal trial, if I'm accosted and I end up using force and killing somebody, if evidence comes up that suggests I was not the initiator, that I was just defending myself and using a proportional amount of force relative to the threat I believed reasonably was applicable to me, then it has to be considered, and the prosecution has to disprove the fact that I was engaging in self-defense. So from the standpoint of nobody's actively trying to kill me here that I'm aware of, I have this right. When I go to some place, Afghanistan, where people will try to kill me, no questions asked, my right is limited. So, from the operational standpoint, there's reasons for that. It's a matter of where should this line be drawn? Why does my right, when I go somewhere where I know people are going to try to kill me, why does my right shrink at that point, as opposed to, hey, I'm back in the U.S. and my right is a lot broader.
Could I just press you on this? What if a lieutenant or a captain who is in command of a relatively small unit says, okay, guys, this is what we're going to do. We're going to sneak up on them, and we don't want them to know how many we have, so don't fire back. And if somebody comes at you with a knife, just try and maneuver out of the way or go with a bayonet, but don't use your weapons because we have to have the surprise. Wouldn't you acknowledge that in a situation like that, everybody is obligated to obey their officer? And then my question is, if you accept that, what's the difference in principle between the immediate tactical situation where you're bound by superior authority and something that comes out of the Pentagon saying, okay, these are the standing rules, but it still comes from superior authority? Aren't you bound by superior authority in both cases?
Yeah, well, you hit upon the point that is the central problem that I have to address.
Yes.
I haven't really found a good approach on how I want to address this yet. Because there are causes, as you noted, that there will be a reason to say, don't defend yourself. Don't use force for whatever reason, for tactical surprise, for whatever reason. And that is justified. Nobody's questioning that. So how I'm going to articulate this difference is a problem. And where the line should be drawn is a problem.
Could I just make a further observation? Because I think that's exactly the right question. Outside of all contexts, every human being is equal to every other with respect to the ability to make decisions. But there are many contexts, including institutional arrangements in the military and civil society, where people are given authority to decide for others. Even if they're not necessarily better decision makers, you need an authority that gets to decide. Otherwise, you have complete chaos. So sometimes some action is better than no action at all. And so there are cases where somebody decides, let's all be quiet, don't fight back or else we'll all be discovered. That's a judgment made by one with authority for the sake of the common good, even if it means risk to some individual. By the way, this idea of you don't get to decide is not unique to military situations. The criminal law tells us all the time, you don't get to decide. We don't care if you're a great driver and going 75 miles an hour is possible for you and you're never going to hurt anybody. Let's just assume that that's the case. The law will still say, we don't care. You don't get to decide, we get to decide. Why? Because as a general rule, if we give the authority to some people who've researched the highways and the curves and so forth, as a general rule, things will be better off. The common good thrives, even if the individual who really wants to go 75 miles an hour suffers in some limited way. Furthermore, when you act in disobedience and you decide to defend yourself, that's an act of civil disobedience, in effect. It's the same whether in the military or in civilian life. It's a disobedience because you're usurping a decision-making power that's not yours to have. It can be done, but if something goes wrong, it's on you. And that's the whole idea of civil disobedience.
I just want to just inject one other thing on the other side. One of the really good things in this, there were many good things, one of the things that really caught my attention in the paper was this German commander who says, we have Taktik, Auflage, or whatever. There you go. and
it took me a while to learn that word.
Yeah, and it's great. And what's really interesting, as my understanding of this is not some post-war sort of nicey-nice, good-feeling thing. This is what they had in the Second World War, and the idea is the soldier needs to have enough general awareness of what we're doing here so that when the order kind of runs out, it doesn't seem to make sense anymore, the soldier has the initiative to figure out this is what the commander would have wanted because this is what needs to happen. Have I summed it up?
Yeah, yeah. So well, it's a discretionary thing.
And actually, what that's saying is if you were a total positivist like Rod Hills here and said, just the law's the law, and that's all you need to know is the law, then you'd have a society which worked just as well as the old Soviet Union, where everybody was I'm not showing any initiative because I don't know, it might be the law, I don't even know what the law is because it's the law, and therefore it's totally mysterious. It's really helpful for people to have a background sense of how should I interpret an order, even in a situation like the military, which is, you think, the model, the example of shut up and obey the order. It turns out effective militaries need to instill in people a certain sense of kind of background understanding so that they can respond like intelligent human beings and not like robots. Yeah, that's a very important point, I think. And it shows that there's something natural about natural law.
Now, Jeremy.
I thought you'd be left speechless now.
You realize, of course, that the New York statutes have codified the canons of statutory construction that largely incorporate all of these norms for reading statutes.
Yeah, but
why you think that's not positive law utterly eludes me. So all of these canons are part of positive law. The fact that they're not part of written statutory law doesn't make them any less positive. And in fact, my favorite consequentialist positivist is Richard Posner. And what is his favorite analogy for statutory construction? You all got it if you took the class on legislation. It's of a junior military officer who receives a garbled command over his radio and has to interpret it because otherwise it doesn't make any sense. And so he glosses it and he says that officer is like a judge in a court. You get a statute and it's got nonsense in it. How are you going to gloss it? You're going to fill the gloss with, well, consequentialism. And my only beef with Colonel Bengs and, you know, the whole idea, the idea of self-defense he's put forward, is I just want him to get rid of the grotius. Everything in the paper would be great if every time you came across the word natural law, cross it out. Just because all that does is this kind of overinflated rhetoric that leads people down the primrose path of thinking that their wallets are being picked. Right? You know, because you immediately think, natural law, what is that? Is that some kind of ultimate religious discretion for some kind of fanatic to defy social convention? And of course it's not. Natural law in this context really either means nothing at all, or it means consequentialism. And I think the judges on the courts martial should be consequentialists, the junior officers should be consequentialist, and indeed our positive law is thoroughly consequentialist. As long as you keep that in mind, you want to call yourself a natural lawyer, cool with me. But don't fool yourself into thinking that when you calculate proportionality and necessity and the rest of this, you're doing anything but, in fact, consequentialism.
You need to get over this phobic, this fetishistic phobia about words like natural law. So you want to call it reason, reasonableness, some other euphemism so that people like you won't be embarrassed. Fine. But I think it's not right to say once you strip away the word, we're all just doing sex and talking about what's consequential. I mean, what's actually involved here is generalizations, because nobody except for Judge Posner knows enough to figure out in every particular case what is exactly the right thing to do. So you need to have a sort of general sense of what generally works. And the general sense of what generally works, if you want to say it's rooted in some guesstimate about how this will work out and therefore it's still consequentialist, okay. But it's helpful to understand that you are not starting from scratch in each case. And you have a certain appreciation for what people have said in general about this generally over the past. And finally, you keep bringing up Grotius. He was the lawyer for the Dutch East India Company. He was a pretty tough guy. You wouldn't want to meet him in court. He was not a sentimental guy. I'm not saying he was right about everything. However, I will say he quotes Thomas Aquinas very frequently and very respectfully. So even your notion that he was off doing a different thing, which is a little spooky and individualistic, no, he presented himself because he wanted to present himself as carrying forward a kind of argument which people still needed even in the 17th century when they were extending slavery to the East Indies.
I'm happy to get rid of Grotius as well. And that's rooted in my view that what you get after Suarez is no longer Aquinas. So Aquinas, again, is being moderated, modified, changed, and in many ways misrepresented from the time of Suarez onward, even if people are quoting Aquinas. I also wanted to say that in Aristotle's and Aquinas' view, there is a kind of consequentialist way of thinking. Like the argument for private property is consequentialist or teleological. I get worried when we talk about consequentialism and think, I'm not saying that you're thinking this, but think of it in strictly utilitarian terms, because if we reduce the common good to an aggregate of individual goods, we run into other problems. But I think the reason why one has to retain some commitment to natural law and not be a complete positivist, and I think holding on to some idea of consequentialism is a kind of natural law way of thinking. But the reason why positivism alone doesn't work is something like this, that even if what we all regard as rational is codified and put into statute or announced through some kind of judicial decision, it's always the case that our concepts, our laws are general, and cases dealt with by concepts and laws are particular. And so even if the law is or the rule is no vehicles in the park, you can find a situation where some judgment call has to be made. No matter how specific the law is, it's always cashed out conceptually, generally. So at some point, someone's going to have to make a decision whether the law, no vehicles in the park, if they use petroleum, if et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And if the particular case is specific enough that it evades any clear, obvious answer, you have to say, okay, does this fall under the law? You have to ask, what's the whole point of the law? And when you ask that question and have to make a judgment when it's not already posited what the judgment should be, it's either possible to get that decision right or get it wrong based on some vision of how things ought to be. A strict positivist, I think, has to say it's neither right nor wrong because it's not been posited. Whereas a natural law thinker wants to say, even if it's not posited, someone can make the right decision based on a vision of the common good or the consequences, if you want to put it that way. So we can't be strict positivists without also being committed to the view that some decisions are neither right nor wrong.
Rick, just a minor kind of point of moral philosophy, that even utilitarians and welfare consequentialists undertake evaluation and judgment with regard to what the relevant consequences are and with regard to how to even weigh up the goods, which, of course, is itself a obfuscatory metaphor, I'd say. And so I think that the first step in any adequate natural law account is just to point out that undertaking of evaluation and choice, which is, I think, unavoidable, and that the consequences and weighing up of goods aren't self-evident.
Yes, the second row from the back on our left side.
David Snyder, American University. Thanks for this terrific panel. I keep thinking that there are two ideas that are getting put together that maybe ought to be kept separate. And a lot of the debate has been about answering what I regard as the hardest question, which is to what degree natural rights have been alienated or are even alienable. I regard that as a very difficult question, and I haven't heard the answer, so I guess it's not obvious. It seems to me a much easier question to ask is, if we are deciding on the best law, should we assess it, should we evaluate the alternatives based on how close we think they are to natural law? Right? And that's how I understand one piece of Colonel Bengs's project and also Professor Baur's project. Say, all right, if we're going to choose laws, let's do it in light of what natural law is. Another thing that we can do that's a lot easier than answering what I regard as the very hard question is to read the positive law we have, understanding that there's always play in it, there's always gloss. But saying, all right, how are we going to understand what the rules of engagement are? How are we going to understand the rules of the social club or the labor union in difficult cases that they don't answer directly? It seems to me we're more likely to regard it as a stronger argument if our interpretation accords with what we might regard as natural law, and a weaker interpretation or reading if it diverges from natural law. So it seems to me if one believes in natural law, that's a very useful role it can play, regardless of our answer to the much harder question. And so I'd like to separate those out. I understand Professor Moreland's point about pluralism and disagreement, and that leads me to the other piece, and I think that's what Rick is saying. You know, natural law, this tells me immediately it's bad, it should be mistrusted, and so on. In fact, I think it's better to go another way. I think because Rick's talking about, he's worried about too much disagreement. He may think that natural law means something different, and so on. But do we base the validity of reasoning based on the amount of disagreement? Because I could be wrong about this, and Rick can correct me, but I think even welfarist consequentialists sometimes disagree with each other. Is disagreement the basis? Is it about consensus? Those are my questions.
Let's start with Rick and move back towards Nick. Anybody who wants to take a text evidence, go ahead.
Well, on the natural, on the alienation, question, a difficult question, whether you've alienated your natural rights. I generally think rhetoric about consent is distracting and unhelpful. People come up with arguments, strained arguments for consent when they think that it'll help them reach the right result. Remember Locke's famous argument, you consented to all the rules of a country because you happen to live there, you know, regardless of how difficult it is to emigrate. I think it's usually more direct simply to say, does this outcome make sense, all things considered? Does this rule make sense? Rather than say, oh, you consented to it because you didn't do X, where X is usually impossible or very difficult. So I would dispense with all that, but that's because I'm not a contractarian, and I generally think that early modern contractarian theories are suppositious and silly. Now, what about this other stuff about, well, using natural law as a benchmark to evaluate rules? Again, if natural law is just sort of a nice stand-in for what makes sense given the conventions of our society, concerning what is good for humans overall, fine with that. I generally think the more direct way of thinking about the problem is closer to welfarism because it allows us to realize that we often have to make difficult choices that are offensive and hard. And I think that often the rhetoric about, you know, what is good, right, and just makes us pretend like we don't have to make those choices. I think Finnis's division of the world into seven basic goods is a way to avoid making those choices. But often we have to have horrible trade-offs, like this soldier, this innocent, brave soldier is going to have to die because we engaged in a war of choice, which all things considered as a matter of realpolitik, we think was a good idea. And so he's going to have to be stripped of his right to self-defense. Now that's a choice we actually have to make. And a lot of rhetoric that says we should do what's intuitively just and right under the circumstances obscures those choices. So I tend to think that consequentialists with a more welfarist bent tend to be a little more realistic and honest in the choices we often have to face. That is to say, we have to do horrible things that are deontological or natural or, you know, just notions say are really horrible and we shouldn't do, because that's the situation you're in when you're leading a great enterprise like a nation. So I think Machiavelli was closer to the truth. A good leader has to forget his soul and love a city. And I think that people who talk in terms of natural law, doing what's intuitively just or right,
often are not as accurate. So that's why I don't like the rhetoric about natural law. I think it adds nothing, and to the extent it adds anything, it probably just prevents us from being less sentimental and more realistic.
At the least, what the rhetoric of natural law adds is a reminder that you're not the first person to think about it. And some of the people who thought about it before you were pretty smart. And some of them even read Machiavelli themselves and thought about how far they wanted to go down that path. So I think it's useful to have people just remember that we've been talking about these things for a long time and pay attention to where you're coming in on the conversation. To the question about, you know, the military and do you give up your rights in the military, that's, a very, very challenging question, because you just think about this for a minute and a half and you realize, whoa, we won't have a military if every member of it can assert his inalienable natural right to self-defense, because we are sending them out to get killed. You're putting them in terrible situations. And just to show that this is not like completely like, oh, I just missed something. I mean, Hobbes, who was the most emphatic about the right of self-defense, says that it's inalienable, says, and by the way, I mean, he's Mr. Social Contract, and he got it, but no, wait, it doesn't make sense if you can alienate the most primal thing, the right of self-defense, so that you can't. But then he says, well, okay, so what happens when there's a war? Well, there's a running away on both sides, and the one who runs away the less wins, right? Because he couldn't think of a plausible way to explain how you say to the soldiers, no, you must sacrifice your life for the others and for your country. But if you can't do that, you won't have a military. So this is a very big problem. It's maybe worth mentioning that we did not have the Constitution first says the Congress can establish separate law for the military, and it was not subject to review by civilian courts until after World War II. That's an amazing fact, right? We literally said the military will be its own law, which is as close as you come in America to saying you gave up your rights to this special authority. But that has to be a special case. And I think if you go back to the question of, like, ooh, rights in general are the inalienable, well, we should all like remind ourselves that the military is very special situation, and we don't want to take that as the model for society.
Just on David's point about moral disagreement, we're marked by disagreement between welfare consequentialists and other forms of utilitarians and social contract rights libertarians, as I mentioned at the outset. And the natural law point there would only be that we need some standard by which to assess, measure, and seek to resolve disagreements, and that's practical reasoning about human goods. And then we can figure out which work better and which don't, and what the criteria for reasonableness would be. And Rick has one, and those of us who are more in a Thomist vein have another.
Well, this is getting a little bit over my head there, so I'll just play it safe, I think. Now, from the standpoint of, it's a voluntary military, so nobody has to be there. So is a consent aspect involved? But consent, I think, it requires a certain degree of information. What do I actually give up when I decide, all right, I'll join the Army, I'll be a Marine, whatever. And that is the piece, I think, that is the most troubling for me personally, in the sense of, do I affirmatively give up entirely my right to defend myself? Now, you'll let me do it in New York, but you won't let me do it somewhere where I'm going to be killed, probably. So, you know, for the honesty standpoint, you're not going to recruit people when you say, you give up your right to free speech, you give up this right, you give up that constitutional right, and you give up the right to defend yourself, unless we say you can. So that is the problem that I have, and there's no clear answer for it, because obviously there's good reasons, and I recognize that, why you would give up this right. Beyond that, I think I'll just pass.
You give up the right, and you get special honor in return.
Of course. I get to wear a nice uniform.
I wanted to affirm the idea that social contract ways of thinking about natural rights, I think, are very problematic and ultimately unhelpful. That's why I don't endorse the kind of natural law thinking that you have after Suarez, even if it still uses the terminology of Thomism. But I'd want to still affirm that there is a difference between being a good citizen as such and being a good human being as such. A positivist has to say that there's no gap whatsoever. It makes no sense even to say that being a good human being can be something different from being good, a good citizen, whereas the natural law thinker wants to hold the view that, that being a good citizen is not fully coextensive and exhaustive of what it means to be a good human being. And to the extent that we have hold that gap open, we're natural law thinkers. I also wanted to point to what I think is often just a conceptual confusion. This gets into issues involving philosophy of language and philosophy of mind. But the idea that we at first don't alienate certain rights and then do alienate them, which is basically a social contract way of thinking, is highly problematic. It suggests that we first have natural rights and then we give up some of them. As if natural law thinking is refers to one thing, this natural law thing that exists on its own, and then positive law comes along as a second thing. In Aquinas' way of thinking, natural law is not related to positive law in the way that one thing is related to another thing outside of it. Rather, positive law is a specification of natural laws. Positive law is the way that natural law, which in itself is abstract, general, and therefore non-existent, positive law is the way that natural law is specified. And there's no such thing as natural law that's not specified in positive law. It's like the relation between being a mammal and being a dog. It's not as if you look at the dog and then look at the mammal and see if they match up to one another. You don't take positive law and see if it matches up to some other thing that you call natural law. It's rather that the dog is the way that mammalian being is specified in a particular instance. And so we measure the defectiveness of positive law, not by holding it up to some kind of imaginary Platonic ideal that we call natural law, but rather by discerning through reasonable, intelligent activity what defects might be in the positive law. Because insofar as anything exists, it has some goodness in it, Aquinas argues, but that doesn't follow the good in every respect. So to know the defectiveness of positive law is not to hold it up to an ideal that doesn't exist, but rather to discern defects in existing positive law.
We have time for one more question. I'm going to call the gentleman in the back row on my right side, the audience's left side, but please make the question quick, and panelists, we have 5 minutes left, so judge your responses accordingly.
My question is for Professor Hills. Just want to push back in two.
Could you identify yourself, please?
Oh, my name is Justin Shubo. Push back in two ways. One is that the consequentialist view can be pragmatically self-undermining if it turns out that talking about natural rights and social contractarian makes for the best possible society, which could well be true historically. Secondly, whether you accept that there is a natural law at the most fundamental level, insofar that to have the rule of law, you can't have ex post facto laws or secret laws. And that I don't think there is disagreement about that once, say, the British tradition or certain philosophers come up with that. They make plain what has actually been there all along, someone like H.L.A. Hart. You go tell some people in Papua New Guinea, and they're like, oh, yeah. For us to have the rule of law, we have to have these constitutive factors, and that's not consequentialist.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking as I sit in here, maybe all this rhetoric about natural law is a good idea to make junior officers and lower-tiered people in hierarchical organizations feel a little bit more independent. I'm thinking of the civil rights movement and the sit-ins. You know, invoking natural law ideas just might make people a little bit more ornery. And that could be a good thing. So I'm not saying that there's not good consequences overall to this delusion that there's a natural law. I think a lot of false beliefs are useful. I actually think we underestimate the value of false beliefs. I think they're often essential for society to function well. I just don't think, you know, that if you're trying to defend something in a scholarly context, rather than trying to beef yourself up to do the right thing in a battlefield, that it's helpful to invoke Suarez, Grotius, Aquinas, etc. I think both the contractarian version and the human good version just don't help that much. I think what ultimately helps much more is to think of the bottom line. And think of the bottom line in fairly crude, I almost want to say welfarist preference aggregating terms. I'm willing to modify that a little bit, but that's just my attitude. I call it brutal realism about evaluating rules.
Anyone else?
It's brutal.
I mean, the question hanging there is because, right? and that's right. The practical reason demands something like a natural law view of whatever provenance in order to fill out that account. But
just very briefly, I don't have very far-reaching worries about the brutal realism, because Aquinas is a very pragmatic, down-to-earth, realistic
thinker, and so he does want to speak concretely about what consequences are and what serves the common good and what doesn't. But I think what does distinguish him from this idea of a brutal realism that involves an aggregation of preferences or preference satisfactions would be something like this. There is such a thing as a common good that defines and gives proper arrangements to social interactions. So the common good is nothing mysterious for him. It's simply any shared end that a group of individuals have on the basis of which they negotiate what ought to be done by them as individuals. So this room has its own common good in the sense that we are all committed either directly or consciously or unconsciously to civil conversation, not insulting each other and speaking the same language. So we have a common end even in this moment. Aquinas says two travelers on the road have a common end, a common good. So the important thing is the common end or the common good is not just reducible to aggregated individual interests. I can give a number of examples, but maybe the best one would be something like a team whose common end would be to win, let's say, baseball games. But you can envision a situation where every member of the team would prefer to swing in order to get a higher batting average for various reasons, get rewards. Every member of the team may well be inclined to do that, and the aggregated self-interest would be best satisfied by that, but it would still be the wrong thing to do because the good of the team as a team is to win. So again, I'd want to say that consequentialism, pragmatism, realism is good, but I think the natural way of thinking, going back to Aquinas again, not the social contractarians, gives us good reason for thinking something that's not already thought in natural law thinking or positivistic thinking, which is, even if aggregating interests does play a large role in understanding what the common good is, that cannot be exhaustive of a common good.
I just gave one example that's a little more elevated than baseball. If you accept that there are things you don't agree with George Will, that's the highest thing. Architecture, and the brutalism made me think of, right, all these, what do they call that, modern architecture style? No, but brutalist, realist architecture, right? And the premise of that is cut it out. The main thing is a roof. And so we're going to have a completely stripped down building which has a roof. And they will admit that that is really what the project is about, the roof. And they're horrible. No one wants to be in them, right? Because actually, that is really reductionist. That's not what a building, that it's one thing a building is about, but that is not all that a building is about. And so if you want to think a little bit more, you shouldn't go at that level and say, the main thing is to keep out the rain. You should actually look at older buildings. And older buildings are actually charming, many of them. They're nice, right? You might learn from them, right? I'm not saying it has to be medieval, but I mean, you should look at older buildings. A lot of really nice buildings built in the 17th century and in the 18th century.
1790 around when Bentham was writing.
Okay, well, I hope this panel was edifying. I am sure it was good, rollicking fun. And for that, I'd like to ask you all to join me in thanking the panelists for the papers and the commentary.